As some of you will remember, intermodalism was a key buzzword of ICE-T, the 1991 Transportation Reauthorization Legislation. All levels of the transportation industry and government decision makers understood there was a need to address how to better share infrastructure for freight and passenger movement in all modes. 20 years ago, in October of 1994, we delivered our recommendations to Congress on the needs of the nation's intermodal transportation system. However, we also observed that there are significant barriers, or they were at the time, to an effective national intermodal transportation system. We highlighted three, specifically that planning and policy, particularly at the federal level, does not encourage or accommodate intermodalism, that federal funding of transportation programs falls short of authorized levels, but more important, is largely directed modally, discouraging investment in intermodal transportation, and that federal government institutions are organized along modal lines, which inhibits planning and developing an intermodal transportation system. Most important, the Commission confirmed the need for a national intermodal transportation policy. We very carefully balanced our recommendations between the needs to more efficiently move both passengers and freight, but really the importance of freight movement to the growth of the national economy was the new entrant to the conversation. Up until the passage of ICE-T, focus, particularly in the post-World War II era, had been very much on the movement at the federal level, very much on the movement of passengers, recognizing that the private sector role in freight is really predominant. 10 years after the Commission had delivered its report to Congress, very little progress had been made to move the public agenda to improve the nation's intermodal transportation system, and most particularly, very little had been done in terms of the movement in the public arena in terms of the movement of freight in America. And what's exciting is that, in fact, in the last number of years, something really has happened. A key question underlying these freight policy discussions is the role of the federal government. The ownership and investment in our nation's freight system is very complicated. The economy of the founding colonies was built around their ports and the freight that moved through those ports, and the governance of ports remains fiercely local. We talk about our nation's port system, but we don't really have a national port system. We have a collection of ports that support their state and local economy, and that's why they were founded, and that it remains an important part of their function. In the 19th century, the federal government played an important role in the development of our inland river, waterway, and canal system. Today, it's operated by the Army Corps of Engineers and is a key part of our transportation system, but needs serious reinvestment. If the locks in the Mississippi River fail, the cargo that moves through that waterway system would overwhelm the rail and highway system. Later in the 19th century, the federal government played an aggressive role in developing the transcontinental railroads. Today, our rail system is largely privately owned and operated and internationally acclaimed. Our port system is based, as I said, on investment by local, state, and county governments. Overall, as you look at the freight system, it really is a patchwork of investment by the public sector and the private sector. Not necessary that the public sector make all of the investment, but it's important that the public sector understand how the investment is made and how to incentivize investment and reinvestment, and to understand that it is part of a global network. Trucking continues to be the primary mode of travel for most freight. Most freight trips either start or end or both with a truck move, but it's the dominant mode for distances under 750 miles. Commercial trucking is an important component of the use of our highway system, about 9% of all highway miles traveled. Rail and water transportation is, as I indicated, a key component, particularly of long distance hauls and the movement of energy and raw materials and agricultural products. Pipelines obviously are also part of those long distance, the infrastructure that supports those long distance movements. It's hard for infrastructure to keep up with changes in commodity flows. When you're building a pipeline, you're building it for 50 years. Air freight carries only a small portion of freight tonnage, but it's the mode of choice for moving high-value cargo long distances. A significant portion of freight, however, is transported on multiple modes. Drivers of freight growth include the growth of the economy and population. Globalization will continue to increase the import and export of goods, placing strains on our ports, our border crossings, and intermodal infrastructure. Innovations in manufacturing, logistics, and vehicle technology will create efficiencies that will continue to transform the movement of goods.